This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
Canine crew, it's time to just sell the damn thing. Doberman Dan is revealing his contrarian formula for getting a rush of new customers, building your business faster, and making the highest possible profits. Go to justsellthedamnthing.com to get your copy today.
Prepare yourself for the uncensored, nothing held back, no BS reality of how business and life really work. Doberman Dan is off the chain.
Our guest this week is such a good sport. There's no prep whatsoever for this call. I just reached out to her and said, hey, you want to be a guest on the show again? She's like, yeah, sure. Like, we didn't even talk about what we're supposed to be talking about.
And that's correct.
and you ask, and I think my response was like, geez, I don't know. What do you want to talk about? You're such a trooper for doing this, Lee.
My pleasure.
So let me introduce you, since I just kind of started running my yap without properly introducing you, everybody, my dear listener, to Lee Milteer. She is an internationally known and celebrated entrepreneur, visionary, thought leader, best-selling author, award-winning professional speaker, TV personality, and business strategist. And I like to consider you my friend, even though we haven't known each other for a long time, we've had a handful of conversations. I just clicked with you immediately, so I'm adding my personal friend to that list.
Well, I'm very honored. I feel the same way.
Well, thank you. That's good to hear. I was actually going to say I don't know if Lee feels the same way, but that's how I feel. Lee's the founder of the Millionaire Smarts coaching program, which supplies done-for-you coaching for other coaches and businesses. And she also runs mastermind events and the Wealth and Power Mastery program. And Lee runs the Peak Performers Implementation Coaching Program for entrepreneurs with the No BS Inner Circle with Advantage. I was almost going to say formerly known as something else, but I'm not even going to mention what they're formerly known as. She hosted the America's Premier Experts TV show, which aired on NBC, CBS, ABC, and Fox affiliates. And Lee also hosts Untamed Success, Positive TV. It's a monthly web-based TV show. And Lee speaks all over North America and Europe in conventions, private companies, and entrepreneurial and niche market events. As president of Lee Milteer Incorporated, career development strategist, she has counseled and trained more than a million people in her speeches. And her presentations are so effective that organizations such as Walt Disney, AT&T, Xerox, IBM, Ford Motor Company, NASA, Federal Express, 3M, Sales and Marketing Executive International, plus hundreds of government agencies and scores of conventions, association meetings, and niche market events repeatedly retain her to inspire and motivate their audiences. Lee has such a CV. How do you pronounce that? Curriculum vitae, however you pronounce that. We could just talk about that alone. This, I will mention one thing that just blows my mind. Lee has authored 13 books, Amazon bestsellers. Just the simple fact of authoring 13 books makes you damn near superhuman in my mind. Some of the titles, Reclaim the Magic, which we talked about that book on the last show, Lee, The Magic of Prayers, plus Women Who Mean Business, her other book, Success is an Inside Job, Spiritual Power Tools for Successful Selling. And she has co-authored the books, Reach Your Career Dreams, Walking with the Wise for Entrepreneurs, The Secrets of Peak Performers 1 and 2, Ultimate Entrepreneur Success Secrets, and Walking the Wise, Overcoming Obstacles. And she's been featured in the book, Woman Millionaires. And Lee's programs are translated into Japanese, Dutch, French, Italian, Spanish, and even the strange language that Mr. Fleming, my high school English teacher, spoke, like we spoke about on a previous podcast.
Raffam Straffam,
good old Mr. Fleming. Lee, you're a powerhouse. It's an honor to have you as a guest. It's an honor to be able to call you a new friend. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. You know, one of my points in life, Dan, has, you know, if you grow up poor, which I did, and you're really striving for credibility as a woman, particularly in this world, your ass better be out there doing a lot of stuff, being prolific. So that was my intentions, and I followed through on that. So thanks for acknowledging that. So what do you want to talk about today?
You've followed through in a big way. I've got a smattering of things I want to talk about, but I totally, something you just said just sparked a thought that I'll start with. Correct me if I'm wrong. I could be wrong about this. I'm often wrong about a lot of things, but you mentioned, you know, being a woman in this business. This world, for all intents and purposes, was created by, you know, a bunch of old white guys. This is an old white guy's world. And it appears to me that any woman entrepreneur who's successful, any woman who's successful in anything, you tell me if I'm off track or not. It seems like you got to work much harder to be able to grab that success than a guy. Am I off track in my thinking?
No, not really. I think that is true. Everything you've said is true. I will tell you, Dan, that I really don't focus in on that at all. You know, my attitude in life is it is what it is. And I can let the story of reality hold me back, or I can say the hell with that. And I'm, you know, marching on and doing my thing. And when I started my career speaking, I spoke at 100 seminars a year for 6 straight years, public seminars for women. And what I heard was victimhood a great deal. You know, it's not fair, and that, you know, women have to work so much harder. And, you know, I used to just listen and go, yes, all those things are true. And what are you going to do about it? Just like everything else. Like, so I could be an old white guy right now. You know, my complaint could be, well, you know, other people are being considered for something and I'm not, just because I'm an old white guy. So my advice to everybody is, it doesn't make any difference what the outside world is doing. The only real competition you have in life is yourself, of upping your game, leveraging your talents, getting excited about life, and putting kind of your binders on and running your own race. And I'm using a quote really from Danny Thomas, which nobody will know who the heck that is, but Marlo Thomas and I spoke at an event many years ago, and she ends her presentation with, my father's greatest advice was put your binders on and run your own race. And so that's always been my motto. I'm running my own race. And yes, I really have had to work a lot harder. And a lot of times I'll stand on stage, Dan, with this long blonde hair with a little Southern accent, and I am discounted right away just for being a Southern woman. However, if you get into a room with me, in a negotiation room with me, I am hell on wheels and I am a gladiator. And it's to my great advantage that you misunderstand who I am.
I love it. So you've used what some people have allowed to be a disadvantage and turned it into a big advantage.
Absolutely. I'm absolutely, because I'm a leverager. You have to leverage what your strengths are. I don't try to be things that I'm not. Like, I don't do my own accounting. I don't do tech stuff. I have a little teeny slice of pie that I am really, really good at, which is communications. It's writing. It's being persistent. I am really a force to be beckoned with, and always have been. I was born with it, but also growing up very poor, you know, made some very clear decisions that money is power, and that it's independence, and that I'm going to earn my own money. I'm not going to be under anybody's thumb. I'm not going to marry for money. It's nice if you have some, but I'm not going to marry you for it. I'm a person who believes that you're always creating your own destiny, and every day you have 5 kinds of energy to spend. So I'll just share with you my philosophy is, you have mental energy. It's what you're thinking. It's what you're allowing to go in your self-talk all the time. And you have, so that's mental, physical energy. So what are you doing every day? I mean, statistically, like I just spoke to a real estate group not too long ago. To honest to God, these people work like 12 minutes a day. I mean, they say they're working, but they're just BSing. So you got mental, physical, emotional energy. So where are our emotions? You know, are you in victimhood? Are you in your Are you in your own personal power? What are your emotions about things? I'm a big believer in, you know, there's a lot of things I can't do anything about, so I'm not going to spend my time thinking about them. I am going to spend my time and my emotions thinking about and doing something about things I actually have control over. So then there's your spiritual energy, which, you know, I've written a couple of books that have spirituality stuff into it as an add-on to business, because I think that most people don't, you know, count that, you know, our whatever our belief systems are, particularly that, you know, there's something higher and smarter than we are, you know, I believe it's true. And why not tap into that source? And then, of course, there's your financial energy. You know, how are you investing in yourself every day? Are you using your money properly? It's not just your money, it's all your resources. And the greatest resource that we have really is the resource of using our talents. So many people don't really use their talents. What they do is, you know, they're influenced by somebody, you know, oh, you should be a lawyer, or you should be this, or you should be that. But if you're not inclined to do that, if this is not in your wheelhouse, it's always going to be a struggle. It's always going to be, you know, agony. So again, every day of my life, I'm thinking about my life currency and how do I leverage it and capitalize on it. See, I'm a very big believer on capitalizing on things. So, you know, because you interviewed me with my book Reclaim the Magic, which I did make a bestseller, but you know enough about being a bestseller that is a very controlled thing. That is because you put energy and effort into it. You know, the average person thinks, oh, you wrote a book and you were sitting at some counter and some agent discovered you and your book became a bestseller. Nothing could be further from the truth. The bestseller came because I did 700 interviews on it. Literally. Right. I mean,
if only it were that easy, write a book and boom.
Yeah, the book writing is actually easy compared to the promotion of the book, the hustling of the book, and all of that. So I actually grew up on a ranch in Chuckytuck, Virginia. And the one thing that I learned is incredible work ethic. And, you know, you see these books like the 4-hour work week, what BS this is, because, and people buy this stuff all the time, you know, like I'm going to be able to be prosperous and successful just working 4 hours a week. Well, I don't personally know anybody who can do that. I've never met anybody who could do that. I've not met this author, by the way, but I think that all that's hilariously insane. I'm a person who believes if you want something and, you know, and you have interviewed me before, I go towards it and I use every aspect of myself to go towards it. And I use laser energy, not shotgun energy. I'm very, very focused on what I want. I'm driven. As a matter of fact, I don't pay a lot of attention to Facebook, but I posted something on Facebook the other day that was very descriptive of me. It was a light switch. And there's an on and there's an off. And on the on, it said obsessed. And the off said totally not interested. And that would be me.
That's a great analogy.
So I'm not interested in things I have no control over. I can't do anything about it. Why would I fret and think and waste my mental energy, physical energy, emotional energy? Now, I'm sorry bad things happen in the world. I can write a check and help other people do something about it. But me wailing on Facebook and screaming on how unfair this is all like screaming at the ocean. It's a waste of your energy. And it's being out of integrity with who and what you really want to accomplish in life.
Good point. I'm to the point that I almost feel like being aware of that stuff is not even something I should do. Like, I don't even need to watch the news. I don't need to know what disasters are happening in the other part of the world, because what am I going to do about it? You know, the best I can do is write a check. You know, I don't need to load my mind down with that kind of fear-based stuff.
I'm totally with you. In fact, you know, our mutual friend, Mr. Dan Kennedy, I'm on the phone with him a couple of days ago and I said, oh, well, here's something bad happened, but I have no idea what it was because I'm not watching the news and I don't get the newspaper and I refuse to look at the Facebook feed of the screaming. And then he told me, okay, this is what Trump did and, you know, this is why everybody's so upset. And I just laughed and we moved on. We didn't even talk about it.
Pick up my guitar and play just like yesterday. You know, it just doesn't affect you. You brought up, you know, the different energies. And the one thing I want to talk about, when you started talking about the using your resources, which includes your money. So the one thing that I would like to hear you talk more about is, it seems to me like there's got to be a balance between the prosperity mindset, but yet being a good manager of your money. Like some people seem to go so, they swing so far to the prosperity side, like, hey, it's an abundant universe and, you know, you can have anything you want. And they're almost teaching the message of, even though they're not overtly saying it, go ahead and piss away every penny you make because it's an abundant universe and you can just continue to make more.
Yeah,
there's got to be a balance there somewhere. And I'd love to hear you talk about that.
Well, first, I think those people are delusionary because, you know, look, I grew up on a ranch farm and this is what I learned. There are times in the season that you plant, you know, you plant seeds for prosperity. And then you nurture those seeds and then you get them up and then you harvest them and then you save some of those seeds to replant. So this is an analogy I kind of think about. It's like, I do believe there's an abundant universe. Do I believe that everything is available to everyone? No. And I say that and people will be upset about that. The reason it's not available to everyone is because they're not using their mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual or financial energy towards that end. They're kind of sitting around, I call them ceiling huggers. They like to sit around and meditate and talk about, you know, everything is great. And look, I'm a spiritual person, but I'm also very grounded into the world that action is what counts. That you just asking the universe to deliver it to you. You know, people sitting around in their living room waiting for Prince Charming to show up. That's not going to happen unless he's showing up at the pizza box, okay? And that's your Prince Charming. So I just think that people have to take 100% responsibility for the results that they get. And, you know, there's a difference kind of between wealth and prosperity. You know, wealth is really managing your money. Prosperity is believing that no matter what, you will, you know, you can do the right things to be successful and take care of yourself. So here's my belief. So if everything went to hell, like, I mean, everything went bad and my whole ability to be a speaker or a writer and all that was cut away from me, I would still survive. Even if I had to figure out, you know, something else to do, like, you know, clean houses, God forbid, I don't clean my own house. But if I had to do that or, you know, be a waitress or I would figure it out. I would not just starve to death. I would not be, you know, expecting the government to bail me out. By the way, when the government sends out checks, Lee Milteer never gets one of those.
Mm-hmm.
Ever.
Nor have I.
And, you know, and that's not going to happen because what is it, you know, such a small percentage of people in the United States even pay taxes. And yet everybody is this suck on the government to make sure that we have, you know, the socialist take care of us attitude is, I find, offensive. Because I was brought up to believe that I can take care of myself no matter what the circumstances are, I can figure it out. And believe me, I've been in some bad scrapes in my life where I had to be very resourceful on how I was going to survive. And somehow I always survived, but it's not like I'm expecting God, who's sitting on a cloud somewhere, to come pinpoint me and take care of me. Frankly, I think God has a lot more important things to do than worry about Lee Milteer.
Right. I was writing, I'm not currently doing it. I have no excuse why. I'm just being honest that I started journaling like in the morning. If you want to call it journaling, I just called it free writing. I should start it back up because all kinds of good things come out of that. But in one of those sessions, I'm not going to take credit for this because probably what it is probably just a synthesis of a bunch of other people's stuff that I put into my head and it got jumbled around and it came out as this. But I wrote this in one of those sessions and I liked it so much, I wrote on a little 3x5 card to keep at my desk. The only thing more powerful than the word is the act, which backs up what you were saying. You know, as popular as that message is, that yes, yeah, we do live in an abundant universe, but then the message that seems to go along with that, that, and you can sit on your ass and money will magically fall into your lap. I've not found that to be true in my case, nor in the case of any successful person I know.
I totally agree. I mean, you know, some people's strategy for their retirement is winning the lottery. And, you know, we know the odds on that. I'm not saying you can't win. I've won the lottery once. I made all of $299. And so,
well, yes, there you go.
I won the lottery, but that would last like a day.
You made $299 more than most people who play the lottery.
Exactly. But it's probably nothing compared to what I put in there. So I just think that people really have to get clear. You know, the title of one of my books is Success is an Inside Job. And that really is an absolute truth. Success is an inside job of how dedicated, how much motivation, how much discipline do you have to use your life currencies in effective, profitable ways. One of the things I ask myself when I use my energy during the day is, you know, what am I doing that's bringing in money? What am I doing that's just wasting time? You know, try to discern on a regular basis, you know, what am I doing? Not what am I thinking? I'm very clear about that. My thoughts allow me to discern opportunities. They really do. So if you're thinking negative and you're all negative about everything, your brain doesn't actually allow you to see the incredible opportunities that are floating through your life every day. They're, you know, that old saying about, well, you know, I missed the train or I missed the bus or I missed it. Yeah, but there'll be another bus, another train, another boat coming. It's just open up your mind and literally say to yourself, program your mind is, you know, opportunities are always flowing to me and I pick the right ones. So I'm playing around right now with investing and I'm learning about investing. And I've invested a long time and, you know, I'm not a genius at investing. There's some losses, there's some gains. But I think the whole concept of where are you investing every day is very important. And if you're not investing in training yourself to be better at what you do, being around like-minded people. So you've heard me say this before. I think that average people are civilians, you know, entrepreneurs, business owners, the awesomes. We are wired extremely differently. We're wired for independence. We're wired for production and creativity and taking risk and, you know, doing extraordinary things. Now, sometimes you win big, sometimes you lose big, but, you know, we're wired to continue to move, sort of like sharks in a good way. But, you know, I get no pleasure hanging around for long periods of time. People who have very secure, like, let's just make fun of, you know, God bless you, government jobs.
Yeah.
You know?
Now you're talking my old language. I used to be one of the government employees. I know.
That's why I use that. So, you know, when you have that, it's like, you know, you go to work, you do your thing. At the end of the day, you know, you can let it go. Your brain can let go. But as an entrepreneur, your brain never can let it go. It's always got to be whenever you're talking to people, whenever you see things, there's in the back of your mind going, how could I leverage this? How could I use this? Why is this important? Should I know this? Should I pay attention to this? And I'm one all the time, 7 days a week. I mean, that's why I love hanging around entrepreneurs because we are alike. We understand each other. I had a high school reunion, painful high school reunion, not too terribly long ago. Oh, and, boy. You know, people are like, well, you know, what's next? And I went, lots of things are next. And they're all thinking about retirement. I'm not thinking about retirement. One, because what the heck would I do? You know, I have to be a person who has a goal to achieve. I have to be a person who's learning something all the time. I read 5 or 6 books at the same time. The people that I'm around that I enjoy are people who are teaching me something. Not talking about the weather or sports or, God forbid, politics.
But it makes trying to relate and talk to civilians makes it really boring and almost painful. I don't want it to make us all sound out to be elitist. But so a friend came to visit a few months back and government employee, and I just thought I have nothing to talk with this guy about. Like, I can't, this conversation is, this is going to bore me to tears. Like I would rather, you know, just go read a book or something than be subjected to this. That sounds so cruel, but I mean, yeah, like I don't understand that mindset, but that is the mindset of probably what, 99% maybe?
Yeah. And, you know, everything in the world, Dan, is teaching people to conform. I mean, all the media is teaching you to conform. You know, the media is, it puts down entrepreneurs, it puts down original thinking. It really wants everybody to do the same thing. I'm not going to fit in that group. I'm not a very social person at all. My idea of a party is going in and saying hello to the host and hostess and eating something and disappearing. I mean, I'm out of there as soon as possible. I made my appearance. I appreciated them. I send them a thank you note, but I cannot hang around people who are unconscious.
That's a perfect description. That's what I couldn't enunciate earlier. I was trying to have a conversation with a person who's unconscious.
And they also, you know, what we can honestly say is there are levels of consciousness in the world with people. And one of my jokes is, if you believe in reincarnation, is most of these people were rocks in the last lifetime because there's not much there. But, you know, I'm being mean. But, you know, I'm actually trying to be funny in the sense of it's a personal choice to read. So there's some statistic that was out a few years ago that the average person, civilians, only read one book a year. And that book is usually a sex novel.
Okay. Well,
it's certainly not success as an inside job.
Well, at least they read something. That's actually one book more than I would have assumed.
Yes. So, and you know, so now we're in a world of everything is, I don't understand Twitter because I don't understand it. It's not that I don't have an account on it, but I've never read it. My staff will put stuff on there just because, you know, there's some social pressure to do this stuff. But I don't understand the whole social media of trying to get likes and approval from people who you're never going to meet, never going to see, who's never going to buy a book from you, who's, mm-hmm. you know, who want everything for free. And they spend hours a day in this activity of really trying to, like, it doesn't happen unless it's on Facebook.
That's exactly right. There's people who, that's their entire life. They have no real human interaction.
I don't get it. So I don't want to be one of those people. It's not that we don't post things because, you know, there's a lot of forcing of trying to, you know, when you're promoting something, trying to be seen. And in this fragmented world that we live in, where, by the way, everybody has an internet television show and radio show. Everybody. You know, anybody can now publish a book. I mean, you know, look at Amazon. What was it? There's 6 million plus books on Amazon.
Wow.
Over 6 million. And there's over 100,000 new books a year posted on Amazon.
Oh, my gosh.
And, you know, truthfully, Dan, a lot of these books look like pamphlets to me. I mean, they're not books. They're like, you know, there's these teeny little things for 99 cents. And so Dan Kennedy, I was talking about, that's not really a book. That's like a brochure. That's not even a long sales letter.
You know, you were talking about conditioning and how, you know, we're being conditioned to all be the same. They want us to be the same. They want us to not rock the boat. They want us to not be able to think. I mean, that conditioning starts pretty much from birth. And then there are the rare people who decide, like, hey, I don't want to be a robot clone. I'm all about independence. I want to do my own thing. You know, and they usually find their way into entrepreneurship, the arts or something. But yet, I found that perception manipulation, that programming, that brainwashing, whatever you want to call it, I mean, that's embedded deep. So how often do you have to deal with that, with bad programming, with mindset issues, with wrong thinking, when you coach somebody, can you just coach somebody like, hey, let's look at your business, look at your numbers. Great. That's what we got. Do this, this, and this. And your clients say, great. They do it. Thanks for that, Lee. It got great results. Or is it more mindset issues? Is it a balance of the two? What do you find?
K9 crew, I know you were digging this interview with Lee Milteer, but as always, we've only got a few minutes with you each week, so we're splitting this up into two parts. You can come back for part two next week. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you then. K9 crew, before you run off, I want to remind you, Doberman Dan has set up an off-the-chain hotline. Call in, tell us you love us. It's even better if you tell us you hate us. It doesn't matter what you say. All you have to do is call in, leave a message. The number is 321-424-6043. Again, off the chain hotline, 321-424-6043.
This is the podcastfactory.com.